All right, well, starting a new video. Guess I gotta say, first of all, thank you for watching my last video. Appreciate everybody that's been commenting. Please keep commenting. Please keep responding to me. I'll always respond to any comments you guys have. I'm curious to see what your thoughts are on everything I'm talking about here as well. I think this is a pretty interesting topic. If you disagree, let me know. If you agree, let me know. But there's definitely a lot here to talk about. This video is going to be about the year 2012 and how it was the apocalypse, but not for humans. It was definitely the apocalypse for movies, though. 2012 killed movies just because I think the studios learned all the wrong lessons from 2012. Silver Linings Playbook came out that year, and that was the last good movie from David O. Russell. I think after that, his inspiration kind of ended, and the style kind of got ran into the ground. American Hustle was pretty good, but some people might say it was too flashy or too consciously stylistic and too consciously David O. Russell. But I think everyone can agree that Silver Linings is still kind of spontaneous, had an interesting energy, had a really good performance from Bradley Cooper and Jennifer Lawrence. That year we also got Safe House from Denzel Washington, which kind of kicked off his transition into out Liam Neeson and kind of creating a whole new prestige grandpa gun genre, since Liam Neeson is kind of the king of that B-movie style grandpa with gun genre. He's kind of like the more elevated or art house grandpa with gun guy. 2012 also gave us the blueprint for the modern video game movies like Sonic and Super Mario with Wreck-It Ralph. And I think there was a lot of encouragement in the success of Wreck-It Ralph and Wreck-It Ralph 2. I let the studios know people are interested in video games. You can start trying to adapt these characters. People want to see these characters. There's a lot of great fanfare around having these characters in movies, even if it was just brief cameos in Wreck-It Ralph. But it all kind of opened the door for the world we're in today, where we've got Mortal Kombat movies, we've got Mario movies, we've got Sonic on his third movie now. So I'm not sure if all those movies are as good as Wreck-It Ralph or made with as much care as Wreck-It Ralph, but you can't deny Wreck-It Ralph started all that. Then on the horror side, you have Sinister, a great performance from Ethan Hawke, and the beginning of Blumhouse's ascendancy, and the beginning of Blumhouse beginning to create its own lane in horror, and then take over the genre by creating a few different genres in horror. Amazing Spider-Man came out that year as well, and I mean, you could make a whole video by itself on what 2012 did to Sony and how it just ultimately destroyed them. But Amazing Spider-Man just came out that year, and that will go on to just completely derail Sony's entire movie slate. They kind of got out over their skis, tried to plan out this big Sinister Six connected universe, and put a lot of stock into Mark Webb and Andrew Garfield, and it totally imploded their studio. It's never been the same after that. They ended up having to give Spider-Man to Marvel to help rehabilitate him. There's a total powder keg there that kicks off. And I'm curious to see what you guys think. Was that really the last time Spider-Man was good? Was Spider-Man good again in the Far From Home, No Way Home era, Homecoming era? I personally think the Andrew Garfield movies weren't that bad. I don't know where all the hate comes from. The second one, I guess, was a little over the top, or I don't know. I'm not sure what the big whoop was. It wasn't that terrible to me. Spider-Man 3, and I really enjoy Spider-Man 3. Of course, I think Spider-Man 1 and Batman Begins are kind of the best of the superhero genre, and I think they help explain why people like superheroes so much, but we'll get back into superheroes a little bit more as we talk about Marvel and DC later and what 2012 did to them. I mean, if you think about Prometheus as well, Prometheus actually was 2012, the apocalypse for both the Alien franchise as a whole and Ridley Scott's career. I think that just derailed Ridley Scott in an incredibly insane way. He started getting into the Alien franchise again. It got weird. The timeline got messed up. Noah Hawley said he's just going to ignore all the Prometheus and Alien Covenant story work when he creates his new series for FX. And I don't think audiences ever really respected Ridley Scott in the same way. They came out for The Martian, but then after that, none of his movies have ever really succeeded. And you got The Last Duel, House of Gucci, you got his most recent film, Napoleon. So overall, I think we're just looking at the end of a legendary career here. Ridley Scott was never able to bounce back in a significant way. Prometheus really caused people to lose faith in him. His ability to choose scripts that general audiences are going to be captivated by. His visuals are still on point. I don't think he'll ever stop being the master of truly cinematic, epic cinema. But audiences just don't really care anymore. Just finished watching The Last Duel, and I think it's awesome. More people need to talk about The Last Duel. He got great performances out of his lead, big gladiator-scale epic as well, and probably one of his more interesting and challenging stories. Kind of reminds me of Meryl Streep and Philip Seymour Hoffman in Doubt. Then, of course, in 2012, we had major franchise entries from DC with the Dark Knight trilogy ending, and I think that really showed that DC was really clueless about what to do with their superheroes. Christopher Nolan came in and had a vision, but Warner Brothers overall doesn't have any kind of direction or concept or idea of what these characters mean, how to translate them to the screen, and what audiences truly enjoy about them. So we end up going through this insane decade of yes and no, and will they or won't they with Zack Snyder, and they consistently try to stop Zack Snyder from executing his full vision, but also don't have a really good alternative as they try to bring in Andy Muschietti with Flash or James Wan with Aquaman. No one's really allowed to fully develop their own vision, and Warner Brothers also doesn't really have a cohesive overall concept. I mean, you could argue that maybe they did, and then Ray Fisher and Gal Gadot complaining derailed Zack Snyder. It derailed the Justice League and changed people's attitude towards DC as a whole, but I just think it was a mess. Everything about DC after the Dark Knight trilogy ended was just strange. Not really good version of the DC characters, not really good action movies. Just a very strange middle ground that audiences mostly weren't worried about. And I mean, essentially, you could argue that where we are with 2022's Batman is just a bad remake of 2012's Dark Knight Rises. I mean, you have the same general idea by the end. This isolated Gotham, this destroyed Gotham, somebody that's attacking the government, trying to reveal the corrupt underbelly of Gotham. I mean, it may very well be that everything going on with the Riddler in this movie was from an earlier draft of what Christopher Nolan planned to do with Heath Ledger in the third Batman film before he ended up passing away. John Carter came out this year as well. And that really handicapped and kneecapped Andrew Stanton's career. He was set up to be the next Brad Bird. After Brad Bird did the Mission Impossible films, he kind of handicapped himself by doing Tomorrowland, and he never got to be the next Brad Bird. Or I guess Brad Bird and Andrew Stanton never got the chance to be the next George Miller, because George Miller is probably the best example of a director that can move from animation to live action and receive critical acclaim and audience attention for all his work, regardless of what medium he's in. I don't know that John Carter was even a bad movie. I think people just didn't pay attention to it. You could argue Disney tried to purposely destroy it due to politics. But I think overall, John Carter was just an ambitious film, a confusing film, but overall, compelling, visually interesting, unique. It suffered the most from being the precursor to Star Wars. So everybody viewed John Carter as a weak Star Wars ripoff when it was really the other way around. And George Lucas took a lot of inspiration from not only John Carter, but other Saturday morning serials, not just Edgar Rice Burroughs stories. I think Buck Rogers, of course, was influenced as well. And you can see that in the DNA of the John Carter film. So they kind of ended up inspiring each other. And that homage confused audiences and kind of scared them away. Then going into other part of what Disney was doing here, Disney also went on to buy Star Wars in 2012 as well. And that destroyed the Star Wars franchise too, because just like DC and Warner Brothers had no idea what to do with Batman or Superman or any of these characters without a clear directorial vision from individual artists, Disney definitely has no clue what to do with Star Wars. And you can tell that they were very skittish about how they put together the plan. They were going to allow three different directors to work on the Star Wars trilogy. And then, for whatever reason, they got cold feet about Colin Trevorrow, J.J. Abrams back. That movie was terrible. And overall, there was just a very reactionary component to the composition of the Star Wars universe. I think you'd actually make a very compelling argument that the same way DC Studios is fumbling its characters due to misunderstanding and studio politics, is the same way Star Wars movies are constantly being derailed and fumbled due to a misunderstanding of the characters and studio politics. It's all the exact same issues. Disney's trying to buy and sell properties. Warner Brothers is getting bought and sold. They're both in these constant states of flux that only really strong creatives can have a clear impact on and influence, because they have to be able to get their vision out no matter what. And you have to have that clear vision to kind of drive you through all these twists and turns in the hierarchy of both of these companies. I think I'll also just take this time to touch on the Avengers too, since we're talking about Disney. And it was the culmination of everything Marvel was working towards, and really the last time Marvel understood its films and made a good movie that showed the full potential of the interconnected extended universe where all the characters were in one shared story. And Joss Whedon understood these characters the best, and this was the last time he was allowed to use the characters without a lot of heavy oversight from the studio. Because by the time you got to Avengers Age of Ultron, he had a lot of setup to do. He had to make sure he met up all with the studio's expectations and notes and crammed all their scenes in. Then he had to cram in all his scenes to justify their scenes. He had to get his humor in, had to get some drama in. And overall, that's where the entire Marvel franchise went. Directors would have a vision, and Marvel would try to cram in more of what they wanted, even if it hurt the films. I think that's what happened to Doctor Strange 2. That's why Scott Derrickson left Doctor Strange 2. I think that's why the Ant-Man franchise struggled so much. I think they just have a desire to put previs on the screen. They develop these scenes with storyboard artists. They don't really have stories around them. And then just demand that directors fit into their mold or leave. So the Avengers was that last time that there was that right mix of interconnectivity, but the studio didn't have such a strong overarching goal that it could derail an artist's vision and override what the director wanted to bring to the story and what the writer wanted to say with the characters. I think Joss Whedon was able to really create a crowd-pleasing film. He knew at the core how to distill these characters into something audiences would enjoy. And I don't think we'll ever see a better example of superheroes on screen. Besides, of course, maybe Sam Raimi with his original Spider-Man and something like Batman from Tim Burton or Batman Begins. But these were very niche characters, and I don't think Joss Whedon gets enough credit for taking characters nobody knew and nobody liked and weaving in five of these characters and creating something cohesive and compelling. I think when we talk about legacies, talk about franchises, actually when we talk about Jeremy Renner, thinking about the Avengers, the Bourne Legacy came out at this time, and that was an attempt to extend that franchise inorganically, and it ended up self-destructing. The Hobbit came out this same year, too, and was another attempt to inorganically extend the franchise, and I don't think audiences really liked either one. These franchise sequels are really needed, but I think the studios just needed to have something to put out, install these properties, and try to revive them, even though there's really nothing else left to say. I think audiences responded to The Hobbit so strongly because of what Peter Jackson did with Lord of the Rings, but he was pretty much brought in against his will because Guillermo del Toro ended up leaving the project. Also this year, I mean, there was Lincoln, there was Argo, there was Zero Dark Thirty. This was really the end of that era where high-quality directors like Affleck and Bigelow and Spielberg could get mid-sized budgets and put out adult dramas for grown-ups without having to have a bunch of sci-fi or some kind of higher concept hook that was supposed to bring in four quadrants for big tentpoles. I think The Hunger Games also came out this year as well, and The Hunger Games is really interesting because it gave us one of the last big movie stars, Jennifer Lawrence, but it was also the end of that tween romance, Twilight era, big book adaptation era in films too, where we no longer see anything like these stories that come from the YA space and kind of take over the entire cultural zeitgeist and take over the box office. Speaking of which, Twilight also went out this same year, and it kind of kicked off two different trajectories for its two leads, where Robert Pattinson would go really indie for a while before going back into the mainstream in the most mainstream way possible by playing the lead in Batman. Kristen Stewart ended up doing the Charlie's Angels reboot and Snow White and the Huntsman before now doing some A24 work of her own and going into that indie space. Pixar also released Brave this year too, and I think it just shows that they're not bulletproof. They just can't take any random concept and make storytelling gold out of it. And I think this was the first time you saw them ever have a chink in their armor. And they did things like The Good Dinosaur, they're struggling, you could argue Elemental, was also something they struggle with, turning their head. They don't always have a clear idea of what the story should be, and it takes a strong director and a strong writer to have a vision, really have something to say with a strong theme. And that's what makes Pixar movies powerful. I think Brave's theme about mother-daughter relationships is powerful, but there was turmoil with the storyline. I believe the original director was fired, and the movie never reached its full potential. John Lasseter also going to leave Pixar after this, and that studio was never really the same after their leader was just fired. I mean, you could argue it was better for their culture, but I don't know that it was better for the films overall. I think it was interesting to look at the fact that we also got a pretty solid January action season. We don't really get that anymore, but I mean, there was Haywire, Soderbergh, Contraband with Mark Wahlberg. They were both pretty good movies. January used to be that place you could go to get solid action films that end up coming on TNT or TBS infinitely forevermore. And those are both really good examples of that concept. I think one of the more interesting concepts that kind of became distilled and crystallized here too was The Rock and Journey 2. So I think it was pretty interesting that Journey 2 came along and kind of solidified that concept of bringing The Rock into a franchise that's flagging and struggling, because he was able to jump into Journey 2. He just did the same thing the year before in Fast 5. And his strategy was working, actually, until 2022, when DC tried to, again, due to lack of understanding of characters, bringing The Rock to play Black Adam, and it destroyed the DC universe and The Rock standing with audiences. So I think when you look back at 2012, you'll see that all the trends and problems we have now in film, what's going on with Star Wars, what's going on with Marvel, what's going on with DC, why there are no more interesting adult dramas, all of it starts in 2012. I think the studios have been repeating themselves since 2012, and audiences have been trying to find more of those high-quality films we used to see at that time. The studios just want repeats, and I think what audiences were attracted to was the originality, the distinct visions of the authors and the directors, and really interesting and intriguing big new stars with people like Jennifer Lawrence, Robert Pattinson, Kristen Stewart. People were willing to take chances on these new actors, but they had to have compelling stories around them. And I think even in franchise films, directors were still trying to create truly engaging stories, whereas now everyone's content to just push product. Studios just want products, and they'll do anything to make a buck, even if it ends up harming their studios and eroding people's trust in movies and the cinematic experience of going to a theater overall. Well, that's pretty much all my thoughts on the idea. I mean, do you guys think 2012 killed movies too? I think this was really the last time anything compelling happened at a major studio level. Let me know if I'm wrong. And thank you for listening.